الله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد، الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها المسلمون، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله تعالى وطاعته، كما قال في كتابه الكريم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: اتق الله حيثما كنت، وأتبع سيئة الحسنة تمحها، وخالق الناس بخلق حسن. ثم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we always say that Islam is the complete way of life, in that it guides us in all aspects of our lives, and this is to our benefit. So there is nothing in the aspects of our lives that Islam left to chances without giving us guidelines. So today I will talk about the vice of laziness. In one way or the other, every one of us has been lazy in not fulfilling his duties, either his mundane duties or his religious duties. And in the end, we pay the price for that. So brothers and sisters in Islam, Al-Imam Raghib says, من تعود الكسل من تعود الكسل ومال إلى الراحة فقد الراحة. So if you get used to laziness, lassitude, and you prefer the life of comfort, of luxury, time will come when you will lose that comfort and that luxury. What he means is, you have a lot of responsibilities. You keep postponing them. You say, I will do it tomorrow and after tomorrow, and it's your own responsibility to do that. Time will come when you will be overwhelmed by a backlog, and you will complain, no one will be there to help. So the comfort that you preferred will avail you nothing in the end. Or if you don't work, assuming that you have all the necessities of life, you choose to stay at home just sitting, you'll pay the price for that. You'll contract some diseases that could have been prevented by the activeness of your body, and this will consume your time, efforts, and a lot of money to get a cure for that. So in any case, if you choose to be lazy and the life of comfort, time will come when you will lose it. So it's very important, brothers and sisters in Islam, for a Muslim to be active in so many ways. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. A strong believer, physically, mentally, spiritually, is better and preferred to God to a weak believer. وفي كل خير, and in both of them there is خير, there is goodness. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us that we should be active, we should work hard, we should be strong mentally and physically especially, in order to be able to overcome our problems and to be able to be good players in the society in which we are. So brothers and sisters in Islam, laziness, according to scholars, is divided into two categories. كسل العقل بعدم إعماله في التفكير والتدبر والنظر في آلاء الله تعالى من ناحية، وعدم النظر فيما يصلح شأن الإنسانية من ناحية أخرى. So the first category of laziness is the lassitude of the mind, of the brain. You don't do brain exercise. Whenever you have problems, you don't think about solutions. You think of getting solutions from other people, from without, whereby you have to think of getting solutions to your problem from within. So you do not think, you do not ponder, you do not consider the bounties and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has favored you with, how to use them properly, how to benefit the community with those bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you do not care about setting right what's wrong in the community and about benefiting the entire Muslim community. So this, on one hand, is laziness. A problem happens, You give the responsibility to another person. You get a problem, you run to another person. The attitude of a Muslim should be that if I have a problem, let me try my best. Let me pit my wit to solve this problem. If you fail, then you can seek help from another person. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the brain to use it to our benefit in this mundane life and in things that will benefit us on the day of judgment. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah number 29, he says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created for you everything on the earth. Everything on the earth, rivers, trees, mountains, mineral resources, all were created for us. So it's our responsibility to use our brains to be active in tapping into these resources to benefit ourselves, our communities, and to do them in the way that we get rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the next category of laziness is qasalul badan. كسل البدن وما يشتمل عليه من الجوارح وينجم عن هذا الكسل تأخر الأمم والأفراد. So this is the lassitude of the body. You don't want to work, you don't want to perform exercises, you don't want to work out, and in the end you become weak because you do not exercise, which is very important. Even, for example, if you have a car, mechanics would advise you that when you travel, you let someone stay with the keys in order every day or every week to wake up and start the car. So if this is a machine that needs to move, what about the human body? It needs movement. It needs activity. If you are not active, it will affect your health. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in so many acts of worship, He encourages us to be active. For example, prayers, there are physical movements. When you perform Hajj, there are physical movements. It means that the body is a trust given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to follow the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on how to take care of our bodies. And if we don't do that, we will pay the price for that. Brothers and sisters in Islam, laziness is among the aspects and characteristics of the hypocrites, the munafiqeen, those who used to claim they were believers. Deep down in their hearts, they were against Islam. They would give the Muslims and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam assurances that we are with you, we are believers, but yet in their hearts, belief was nowhere to be found over there. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِنَّ أَثْقَلَ صَلَاةٍ عَلَى الْمُنَافِقِينَ صَلَاةُ الْعِشَاءِ وَصَلَاةُ الْفَجْرِ وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِيهِمَا مِنْ خَيْرٍ لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَوْ حَبْوًا وَلَقَدْ هَمَمْتُ أَنْ آمُرَ بِالصَّلَاةِ فَتُقَامُ ثُمَّ آمُرَ رَجُلًا فَيَأُمُّ النَّاسِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ ثُمَّ أَنْطَلِقُ مَعِي بِرِجَالٍ مَعَهُمْ حِزَمٌ مِنْ حَطَبٍ إِلَى قَوْمٍ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الصَّلَاةَ فَأُحَرِّقَ عَلَيْهِمْ بُيُوتَهُمْ بِالنَّارِ. رواه البخاري ومسلم. In a hadith that was narrated by Abu Huraira, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, the heaviest and most difficult prayers for the hypocrites are two: Isha prayer and Fajr prayer. Why? Because the hypocrites always wanted to impress the Muslims. They wanted the Muslims to see that they were practicing Islam. So they assumed that during Isha, not so many people would see them. And anyway, it would be dark. So whenever they went to pray, they assumed during Isha, no one could see them go to pray. Number two, they were lazy. After having dinner, they would stay gossiping until sometimes midnight. So it was very difficult for them to perform Isha prayer. Salat al-Fajr was also difficult for them because they stayed long hours at night talking, gossiping, they slept late, so it was difficult for them to wake up early in the morning during the Fajr prayer. Also, during the Fajr prayer, because they assumed that not so many people would go to the mosque to see them, they were not encouraged to go because their aim was about showing off. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 142. He says, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَهُوَ خَادِعُهُمْ وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصلاة قاموا كسالى يراؤون الناس ولا يذكرون الله إلا قليلا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the hypocrites seek to deceive Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will punish them on the day of judgment gradually for their deceit and deception. And they, whenever they stand up to pray, they stand up with laziness and to show off of men.
and they do not remember Allah, they do not mention Allah except a little. So that when they even pray, they pray with laziness. This is among the vices and characteristics of the hypocrites who used to claim they were Muslims, but yet in their hearts Islam was nowhere to be found. So brothers and sisters in Islam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues, he says, وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِيهِمَ مِنْ خَيْرٍ لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَوْ حَبْوًا. If these hypocrites knew the benefits and the rewards that would accrue to them in performing the Isha and Fajr prayer, they would make sure they attended these prayers even though it entailed them to crawl, going to pray. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us that these prayers are very, very important. If you are able and go to the mosque to pray Isha and Fajr especially, you will be far away from the munafiqeen. You will not be branded as a munafiq, because actually this is one of the attributes of the munafiqeen, not to pray these two prayers. And these two prayers are very, very important. In so many ayat in the Quran, when we sleep, we are half dead. So before you go to sleep, the last thing to do is to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Salatul Isha. You have wound up your work, now you are going to sleep, you are in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many people go to sleep and don't wake up? They die while asleep. So the last thing that you have to do is to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When He takes your life, when you are asleep, you know that you will be safe. So it's very important to pray Salatul Isha. Also Salatul Fajr, this is the best time in which you can invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can get your pleas answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he visited his daughter Fatima, and he found her asleep. It was after Fajr prayer. She was sleeping. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told her, قُومِي فَاشْهَدِي رِزْقَ رَبِّكِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى يَقْسِمُ الْأَرْزَاقَ مَا بَيْنَ طُلُوعِ الْفَجْرِ إِلَى طُلُوعِ الشَّمْسِ. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam encouraged his daughter Fatima, wake up, don't sleep after Fajr. This is the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will distribute his sustenance, will distribute provisions. So you have to be awake. This is a good place, and that is a well-blessed time. That is the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you, when we do not have any distractions. The environment or the atmosphere is calm during that time. So these two prayers are so beneficial, and if you are able to perform them, you will be a real believer and you'll reap a lot of benefits and a lot of rewards will accrue to you by performing these two prayers. So you should avoid laziness especially in praying. So brothers and sisters in Islam, it's very, very important that we avoid laziness. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam continues. He said, I had considered to command someone to perform iqama, so that Muslims stand up to pray. So I assign someone and command him to lead the prayer on my behalf. Then I go with strong men, with bundles of firewood, to the houses of those people who did not come to pray, so that I burn with fire their houses. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam considered going to the houses of the people who did not come to pray, especially Salatul Fajr, to burn their houses, because it's very dangerous if you do not come to pray such a prayer. So this is an aspect that we have to avoid, an aspect of laziness. This is why, according to Sunnah, you have to sleep early so that you are able to wake up to pray Salatul Fajr, which is good for you, good for your health, good for your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second aspect of laziness is your body. You don't work, you don't exercise. Working is very important. Even though you are a rich person, you have all the amenities of life, work does not necessarily mean that you need to work to get wealth or to get money. But it's an act of worship. Even though you are not benefiting a lot by working per se, you are actually worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَقُلِ اعْمَلُوا فَسَيَرَى اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell your followers that you should work. Indeed, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see your work. Allah will observe your work. He will reward you for your work, and His message messengers will also appreciate your work and the believers. So we are always encouraged to work, because when you work, you get experience. You get to know how to deal with people. You acquire different skills, interpersonal skills that you cannot acquire when you are at home. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam again tells us, "Al-mu'minu alladhi yukhalitu an-nas wa yasbiru ala adhahum khayrun min al-mu'min alladhi la yukhalitu an-nas wa la yasbiru ala adhahum." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a believer who interacts with people, they harm him, they annoy him, he consistently continue doing that, is better in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a believer who does not interact with the people. So interaction with people is very, very important. And in this, we learn how to do da'wah, how to lead people to Islam. It's our responsibility, whether you know only one ayah, to do da'wah to the non-believers. So if you do not interact with them, how will they know about Islam? How will they be affected by your good behavior, so much so that they will be attracted to learn more about your religion, and maybe finally they would choose to become Muslims? So it's very important, brothers and sisters, to interact with one another. And one of the benefits of working is that you get the opportunity to interact with different kinds of people. But when you stay at home, this is not good for you. So you will be affected mentally, physically, psychologically, and religiously if you choose not to work. And also, if you choose not to perform physical exercises, it will have some health implications on your body. This body is a trust given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to improve our health so that we please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is all to our benefit. Allah does not benefit from that. We are the beneficiaries from improving our health. It will benefit us in so many ways, so much so that there is a correlation between the body and the brain and the mind. So if the body is healthy, the mind will be attentive, you will be attentive. But if you are suffering from some kind of disease, it will distract your attention. So brothers and sisters in Islam, it's very, very important that we are active in working very hard to improve our lives and the lives of those whom we love and the Muslims at large, and also to work very hard to do da'wah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should not under any circumstances just lean towards luxury and comfort when there are a lot of responsibilities that we can carry out. So scholars tell us, إِيَّاكَ وَالْكَسَلُ وَالضَّجَرُ فَإِنَّكَ إِنْ كَسَلْتَ لَمْ تُؤَدِّ حَقَّ وَإِنْ ضَجَرْتَ لَمْ تَصْبِرَ لَحَقَّ. So scholars say that beware of laziness and weariness. Indeed, if you choose to become lazy, you will fail to carry out your responsibilities on different levels. And if you are overwhelmed with weariness, you will not be able to patiently persevere in demanding your rights and doing things that are beneficial to you. So these two vices, we have to avoid them, laziness and weariness, according to scholars who have gone deep into this topic. So brothers and sisters in Islam, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam mobilized a neighborhood of some Arabs to go and defend the interests of Muslims. And to defend Muslims, he had classified information that there were some imminent attack towards Muslims, and he wanted these people to go and deter these people from marching towards the Muslim community to harm them. So the people slackened, they were so lazy, they did not hearken to the call of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah revealed in Surah Tawbah, ayah number 36, إِلَّا تَنْفِرُوا يُعَذِّبُكُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا وَيَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ وَلَا تَضُرُّوهُ شَيْئًا وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them that if you don't go forth as mobilized by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah will punish you subhanahu wa ta'ala with a severe torment, and he will replace you with other people who will follow his commandments. And there is no way that you can harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is the most able to do everything that he wants. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these people, because they did not oblige church to the command of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to mobilize, to go and protect Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala withheld rain from them. They did not get rain for some time because of the laziness. So because they were lazy, they suffered not getting rain. And you can imagine how much efforts they rendered in order to get water. So they used to get rain from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but when they did not hearken to the call of the Prophet, Allah withheld it from them. As a consequence, they had to suffer. So if you choose to be lazy when it's the time to work, to be active, you will pay the price. And maybe you will work even more than what you should have done before suffering the dire consequences of being lazy. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu narrated that a man from the Ansar, the inhabitants of Medina, came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to beg of him. This man was poor. He wanted the Prophet to give him some charity. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked him, "Ama fi baytika shay'un?" Don't you have anything as an asset in your house? He said, "Yes, bala. Hilsun nalbisu ba'dahu wa nabsutu ba'dahu wa qa'bun nashrabu fihi min al-ma'." So this man said, "We have something. We have a mantle, a frock, half of which we wear and half of which we spread when we sleep. And we have a tumbler in which we drink." So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, "Itini bihima," bring them to me. So when the man brought these two assets to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gathered his companions and he offered these two items for sale. One of his companions said, "I will buy them for one dirham." The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, considering one dirham to be an equal to the value of these two assets, he offered to other people to say, "Who will pay more than one dirham?" One of the companions said, "I will pay two dirhams." So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted the two dirhams and gave this person the mantle or the frock and the tumbler. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam took the two dirhams and gave them to the Ansar, and he told him, "اذهب فاحتطب وبع ولا أرينك خمسة عشر يوما." So go away, go and cut firewood, sell it, and I don't want to see you before 15 days. In other words, go and work and come to me after 15 days. So the man went as instructed by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He went on cutting firewood, selling it. He came back with 10 dirhams. So he was able to buy food and clothes for his family. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, "Hadha khayrun laka min an ta'ti al-mas'alatu yawm al-qiyamah nuktatan fi wajhik. Innal mas'alata la tasluhu illa li thalatha: lidhi faqrin mudqi', أو لذي غرم مفضع أو لذي دم موجع." So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when this man came with 10 dirhams after getting profits from the work that the Prophet recommended for him, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, "This is better for you than continue to beg of people, because if you continue begging of people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will humiliate you on the day of judgment. You will come with blemishes, you will come with moles, you will come with scars, and everyone will understand that this person was a beggar." So the Prophet continued to tell him that indeed begging is not allowed except in three situations. It's allowed for only three categories of people: someone in abject poverty who does not have the necessities of life, that one can beg. And the second one is a person who is heavily indebted. He has a lot of debts, a lot of credits. There is no way he can pay them off. So this person is allowed to beg of people in order to help him clear the credits. And the third one is a person who is critically ill, who cannot afford medical care. So this person is also allowed to beg. But if you do not fall into these three categories, then you will be in danger on the day of judgment. Again, this is a sign that people should not be lazy. They should not take it for granted. They avoid working and they go on begging instead of working and acquiring a lot of skills. Because if you beg, you are humiliating yourself, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored you. So brothers and sisters in Islam, in any case, whether you are poor or rich, you should always be active. It's good for your body, and more importantly, it's an act of worship for which you'll be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Abdullah ibn Nadla, Malik ibn Nadla says, عن مالك بن النضر رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الأيدي ثلاثة فيد الله العليا ويد المعطي التي تليها ويد السائل السفلى فاعط الفضل ولا تعجز عن نفسك. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in a hadith that was narrated by Anas ibn Nadhla, his Malik ibn Nadhla, he says, there are three categories of hands. The highest one is the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he gives without measure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his wisdom, he gives and he does not fear of poverty because he's the owner of everything. So it's the highest hand. And the second, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the person who always gives, whether in prosperity or adversity, he will always give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the lowest hand is the hand of the beggar. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged his companions that give from your surplus. If you are a businessman, don't give from the capital. From whatever benefits you get, then you give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not be stingy on yourself. Don't be miser on yourself and on your family, because everything you accumulate here in this world, time will come when it will crumble. Whatever will help you will be the good deeds that you performed, and supporting yourself and your family is an act of worship for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I end with this hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's also about laziness, especially in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And especially when people are enjoying the sleep and they become lazy to wake up and pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So brothers and sisters, to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, an Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu qala, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعقد الشيطان على قافية رأس أحدكم ثلاث عقد إذا نام بكل عقدة يضرب عليك ليلا طويلا فإذا استيقظ فذكر الله انحلت عقدة فإذا توضأ انحلت عقدتان فإذا صلى انحلت العقد ثم أصبح نشيطا طيب النفس وإلا أصبح خبيث النفس كسلان. رواه البخاري ومسلم. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, when you go to sleep, the devil will come to you and it will tie three knots on your forelock and it will encourage you to enjoy a deep sleep in a night that will seem to be very, very long. So when you wake up during Fajr prayer and you mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you say the dua, there is a dua that you have to say when you wake up. You praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one knot will get untied. And if you perform wudu to go and pray Salat al-Fajr, two knots will untie. And if you pray Salat al-Fajr, all the three knots that the devil tied on your forelock will untie and you will wake up active, in a good mood, friendly, enjoying yourself, positive person. But if you don't wake up on time to pray Salat al-Fajr, you don't remember Allah, you don't celebrate the praises of Allah, you don't perform wudu and you don't pray, you will wake up lazy, melancholic, antipathetic, and people will characterize you as a sly person. So brothers and sisters in Islam, beware of laziness. It will not help you in any way. وصلوا وسلموا بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات الذكر الحكيم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. So brothers and sisters in Islam, brain exercise and physical exertion are very, very important in our lives and they are actually an act of worship. According to psychology, the cleverest person only uses 10% of his brain capability. 90% is just over there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a lot of abilities. It's our responsibility to know how to use these blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to benefit ourselves and the community in which we live. If we don't, we will bear the dire consequences of that. And if you perform physical exercises, you work out, it's good for yourself and you are actually worshipping Allah by doing that. So don't think that living a comfortable life is good for you. Time will come when you will pay the price for that. So brothers and sisters in Islam, start being active. Make an action plan of doing exercises, encouraging your family members to do that. Even if you have a lot, everything in your life, you have to continue working. There are a lot of people who have plans for retirement. He says, when I retire, I will be a farmer. I will do this and that. So don't say because you are a retired person, person, you will just sit, sleep and eat. This will cause a lot of health problems to you, and also it will be detrimental to your health, and it's a big responsibility for which you will be questioned in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وصلوا وسلموا على من أمرتم بالصلاة والسلام عليه عموما بقوله تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى